We're back! Hello and welcome everybody to the Defense Season 4 Qualifiers. My name is Epi, I'm very happy that you're here. I can't do too much of an intro because there's some stuff that happened on the live stream. I do thank you guys for tuning in. We are here in game number 2 between Keita as well as Rat in the Dark. Game 1 did go to Keita. Here we are in game. The draft already happened. I will explain to you as things unfold. We might have a level 1 fight here, that's why I'm keeping my camera on here. I am not by myself. Again, this is game number 2. First game went to Keita. I am joined by Ezalor. Thank you so much, my friend, for joining me and also for kind of managing the little problem we had here.
Yeah, man, it's I just thought to chat with the Lions first, so I had something to think about while the stream was gone, but seems that all the problems are gone right now.
Yep, I agree. The horn is sounding. If you are interested in finding out about the draft and what happened for the live stream people, just go to joindota.com and then look at the match in the ticker on the side. You click it and then you will be able to have a look at the draft and how it developed. And if this is a VOD right now that you're watching on YouTube, on the Join Dota YouTube, then also pause the video right now, go to Join Dota on the right hand side, then you will be able to see the match and you can check out the draft, provided you're watching this VOD within like 1 or 2 days after I uploaded it. Anyway, but you were watching the draft while I was gone. Anything interesting right now? I'm looking at the teams. Anything you want to mention?
Well, we got a trend from Rat in the Dark. I'm not sure if that's special. The special thing that is, though, that they put him in the mid lane instead of as Sportle like they did last time. And they have a Queen of Pain solo bottom. I'm not sure how Queen of Pain is going to put up against Landruid. With the armor, it might be decent, but it's still going to hurt a lot for her to be tanking the creeps all the time. Top lane though, again, it's gonna come down to the aggressive try lane. What happens here?
Okay, so top lane, let me get organized here in the game. We have a Jakiro for the first time in ages with a Rubick and a Naix try laning against a Luna, a Nyx Assassin, and that chat. Okay, that was it. Okay, that's why I was kicked out of the game, or my computer just capitulated after Nyx Assassin and Shadow Demon were picked, so. Alright, and one guy's asking in the chat, how much have we missed Dota Zebro, that is? You have not missed a single thing. We have indeed remade the game, and just for you guys, and for myself, of course. So, we're not missing anything. So, we are casting all these games, the qualifiers will be televised, and everything looks to be going quite well. And Trent Protector in the middle lane versus Alchemist. We don't see this every day. This has the feel of, like, old-school Dota 1 days.
Well, you have Alchemist, who's wanting to farm up top lane.
Top lane, what's happening here? We have an initiation, a open wounds on a Luna. Again, the work being done by the Train Protector's living armor, though. A good stun also by Lapis on 2 heroes. Maglev Gangtrain in trouble. Look at that. Oh my goodness. Daco, the first one to go down. It's the Shadow Demon. Maglev Gangtrain in trouble as well. He goes down to Nyx Assassin. Nyx Assassin himself now in trouble, though. Lapis turns around, tries to run away. Nakes, in the meantime, already dead. Another living armor gets thrown up onto Lapis. He survives, and Rubick goes down in exchange for that. People dropping left and right, and when it's all said and done and the dust has settled, Rat have 2 kills and Keita have 1. Who came out on top? Is it Rat because they got 2 or?
Yeah, definitely because one, they got 2 kills and they have got the carry, got the lifesteal down. Didn't get first blood, so gold's about ahead, but they got the carry down. So it's going to be a lot of experience going towards the Luna. And lifesteal's going to drop a little bit behind in lane. But as I was saying about the mid lane, you put an Alchemist there because you want it to farm up. And a Trent Protector, with his 100 base damage basically, he can deny every single creep if he's doing it properly, which he is right now. He's in the top of Lusts and Denies. So Alchemist's not gonna get a lot in that lane, actually.
Yeah. That's true. I mean, Trent Protector, his last thing is pretty insane. He does have a bottle right now, and oh man, this game. To be honest, one part of me says, let's hope for a great game number 3, another part of me says, please, I need sleep, but, I mean, as long as it's fun games like this, it's definitely worth it. And again, that exchange by Rat in the Dark was brought to us, again, by the living armor from Trent Protector. It is so strong in the early laning phase. It's like, as soon as you have a Trent Protector on the enemy team, you just need to be careful. I don't even know, what are you supposed to do as a tri-lane? Because on one side, as a tri-lane, you have to fight, because you need the experience and so on and so forth. But if you're up against a Train Protector, you can't really fight. Oh man, Darko, top lane. Open wounds is going to be used. Maglev Gangtrain, not so sure whether to engage or not, and he does not. We have Sifla now here as well on Luna, but it's just a little bit of dancing back and forth. So yeah, what do? Do you abandon the lane, have the supports roam around and play it defensively, or what can you do against a Trident Protector?
Well, usually against an aggressive tri lane, you have a few options. Mid lane is Cresselia.
Top lane initiation, Seaflag gets opened up again, that living armor. Target switch immediately though, so these guys are learning. Dakono getting focused. The dual breath gets thrown out as well, and Shadow Demon, the first one to go down. Now Seaflag needs to back out as well, and that is exactly what you said the first time we cast the Trident Protector. You need to switch targets as soon as the living armor is thrown out, and that's exactly what they did, and they succeeded.
Yeah, definitely great job by them there. I was gonna say they're not gonna be able to fight the Trident, but if they're gonna have good coordination like that, you saw all three heroes get instantly switching targets. Really great play by them there. Just normally against an aggressive tri lane, you can try to fight it, but with the Trident Protect on the enemy team is very hard. So what you might want to do, get a jungler, just know that you're gonna lose that lane, you're not gonna get much there. Try to get much in other lanes, maybe roam around with your supports more, and get a hero on the safe lane who is able to solo there decently. Like something like Lifesteer can do decently, but something like a Lone Dude or Weavu just do just as well. And then just leave the lane, because you're not going to win that lane. Mm-hmm. Just make sure you win the other two. Kata though, they've decided to stay here and make it happen in the stri lane. And they're doing very well actually with their supports farming up decently. Proper coordination in the stri lane, and just top-notch play coming out from them right now in the early game.
Absolutely. Steph Style, he's sitting at 6-1, 0-0-2, Frigo lead 1-1-1. It's a 2-2 score. 5 minutes and 45 seconds into the game. How is Alchemist looking inside the middle lane? He's sitting at 23 for 4 last hits. 5 minutes into the game. How is... And 30 for 12 for Trident Protector. So this trend in mid lane is working out quite well. Top lane, a lot of action going on. Seafly has living armor on him. Dako needs to back out. He's eating a lot of burst damage. Steph Style gets focused down. Luna gets the last hit there. It's a great victory for Rat in the Dark right there. Frigo lead on the run out. He has no mana left. He's absolutely getting focused down. There's another nuke from Luna flying out, but there was no follow-up stun from Nyx Assassin just yet, as it only cools down as I had a look on the hero. Maglev gank train has 3 points in his rage, but in the end, there's nothing he can do when his support is missing. Now there's a chain stun onto Maglev Gangtrain. He has to rage, the right click's coming through, and he will probably have to back out, go all the way back to base, because there's no one with a salve, and the tangos don't help that much.
Yeah, and like I said, against that Lifesteer, you're gonna need some physical damage, and if you have a Luna in his lane with 2 other supports, you're all gonna get your attack speed. Attack damage buffed by so much that you'll actually be just he's not gonna do much in his rage. You're still gonna wear him down easily because you have so much physical damage right now coming out. And that's why Luna is also a decent hero against Lifesteer in the early game. He'll shut down his lane. So Lifesteer right now not getting much. He's only 16 lost hits while Luna is 28. And that's just showing because he can't get close to those creeps.
Yeah, he TP's back up to the top lane. And one thing that's going Nakes' way though, and I'm not exactly sure why, maybe it's because the supports on Rat in the Dark were soaking up more experience than the other supports. Okay, we have Nyx on 5 and Dako on 3 and almost 4. Because Nakes, he's 6 and Luna, 5. How are the supports looking? Rubik, 3.5 and 4.5 on Jakiro. So that's where the experience difference is coming in. The supports are underleveled from Keita.
It definitely, it's really for them. And what I've actually not seen yet for Rat in the Dark, they haven't been pulling themselves, because if you're running an aggressive tri lane in the top lane, then your own supports can pull the high camp. But they've decided not to do that. They put a ward behind the pull camp, and they're just going to contest it like they're doing right now. Mm-hmm. But Nyx Assassin just runs in, they know they can dive, because once they get on Nyx Assassin, he gets a little bit low, there's strength attack with living armor.
Oh man, there's that spike carapace. Sifla, he gets the living armor, and Trident Protector was waiting just for the open wounds, gets thrown out. Lapis, he's eating a lot of damage though, gets defensively disrupted. Amazing fight from Rat in the Dark so far, such a good coordination, but in the end, is it going to be enough? That's the question. Sifla getting focused down right now as well. Nyx Assassin already dead. Now Luna, she's going to follow, courtesy of that slow from the Orb of Venom. Dako backs out, and Keita kill 2 on top, and that is even though the living armor was in Rat's favor. Then again, living armor doesn't win the team fights.
It's not going to win team fights for them, but for small size scrimmages like in the early game, which we have in Tri-Lane versus Tri-Lane, Trident Protector just does so much. Imagine what would have happened there if they didn't have Trident Protector. It would have been just way worse. So, it was bad already, but it could have been worse.
Yeah, they lose 2 heroes on top. The Luna and the Nyx Assassin, and it all looked so well from them. It was such a great disruption, but then again, Luna just wasn't really tanky enough at that point in time, and Keita, they still had all their heroes. If perhaps they were able to kill one of the supports from Keita before the disruption came in, oh, Maglev ganked an out of mana, the stun misses barely though, so unfortunately not enough from Lapis, but that mana burn could have very well meant Nyx's death, but again, great reaction on the Lifestealer. He quickly went for the Magic Wand charges, he activated those, and then afterwards went for the Rage. So even if that stun would have been in Rage, I believe that Maglev Gangfin would have been fine. So quick on the fingers, even though it's pretty late over there as well. Let's switch over toward the middle lane. Sisso, he is completely skipping Greavel's Greed, so a very, very different Alchemist than we're used to seeing. 42 last hits, Imbiz Rune in his bottle, 3 points in the Unstable Concoction, and 4 in his Acid Spray. So I don't know if that's a... Do you think that's a correct skill build if your solo mid opponent is a Tram Predictor who really doesn't care about a level 4 Acid Spray? Like, shouldn't you try to go Greavel's Greed then instead?
I think they're not... they're picking up that early... Oh, the mid laner, now they're gonna try to kill him.
Yeah, setting up the stun. Imbiz Rune being very, very helpful. I think there's no... They stacked that stun too much for my liking, but still, it's still enough. Jakir gets the last hit.
Yeah, great play there, just good initiation with the Infest Rune you have in his bottle. And that's what they're gonna be looking for, pickups like this, because I think Alchemist will be building into a Shadowblade even before he finishes his boots. And then they're gonna look for a pickoff and then push the towers juicing the Lone Druid and the Acid Spray and the Liquid Fire from Jakiro, which he hasn't skilled yet, but he might. But always when I'm watching a Jakiro, I cringe a bit when they don't skill at least one level on Liquid Fire, because it does so much against towers. It slows the attack speed down by them, so you can just dive tower like no problem. And it also deals crazy amounts of damage against it, so I think you should always get at least one level in it, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we saw a time as well where Liquid Fire had a very high priority on Jakiro when the Dota 2 metagame was all about pushing towers early and hard, and as I said in one of the previous casts, you know, it was definitely...
Mid lane?
Yeah.
Ooh, he's safe. But, yeah, definitely, builds used to be different like that. Liquid Fire is way better in pushes, but now you just need nuking them for those pickups, and that's why people max out Dual Breath, because it actually deals a lot of damage.
Yeah, it certainly does. Alchemist he's actually going for a mech at this point. We have drums up on Luna already, 400 gold, the power treads, arcane boots on Tram Protector, so both solo mid heroes are going for a mech early on. How's Lifestealer looking? 1100 gold, so he's still relatively far away from his armlet. And very important is Phlox Phlox, 34 last hits, and I think Queen of Pain is definitely oh, she's destroying that lane, 59.
Top lane though. Nyx Assassin, it's for that they're gonna look for something, but there's nobody behind the tower, on the other side of the tower. And when he gets to the other side, his Vendetta's already worn off, so they're not gonna get much out of that.
Maglev Gangtrain, he actually goes aggressive! Look at that damage up, with defensive disruption thrown out one more time. Sifla throws out the ultimate, it does quite a bit of damage. Infest by Maglev Gangtrain, though the Living Armor keeps Luna alive for now. The right click's coming through, good stun by Lapis, catches all three heroes, and the ultimate from Spin! She rotates in, blinks in, screams, kills the first one. Will there be more? She's out of mana, needs to be careful, the Haste Rune is so convenient for her right now. Look at all the heroes on Rat in the Dark, so low. But Rubick, the only one down from that engagement, there was so much use on that top fight.
Yeah, great play from Nyx getting a 3-man stun. Mm-hmm. Just if it wasn't there, Luna would be dead for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Living Armor was on cooldown as well, but mainly what's coming into play there is that Queen of Fame was able to get so far ahead over Lone Druid.
Mm-hmm.
She's 2 full levels ahead. Trent's gonna be pushing out bottom right now, but 2 full levels on the in the solo lane, that's a lot.
Yeah, that
and
is.
And it's all due to that Trent protector armor attack, that she can go so aggressive. It doesn't only do work for your triad for those keeping those heroes alive, but against the Lone Druid, you usually have to bear wear enemies down by just hitting them constantly in the lane, and you can't really do that once Living Armor gets up. Living Armor just makes sure that Harris actually does nothing.
Yeah, that's correct. I mean, by now, the Spirit Bear, with the phase boots and stuff, starts doing damage even regardless of the living armor. But as you said, during that laning phase, during the early stages, I mean, we saw how aggressive Quap was able to just stand against the bear. The bear was standing there right-clicking away on Quap, and she really did not care. She didn't take any damage. She was healing up due to the living armor. And she, even on level 7, she had 4 points in her scream, 2 in her Shadow Strike, 1 in Blink, because she just wanted the lane control. She didn't want the ultimate to burst down a hero like a lone druid. That would be pretty bad skill build. So instead, she decided to go for the full-on lane control, and once she had her ultimate, she had her chance to TP top, rotate, and make something happen. Granted, she only got 1 kill on the Rubick, but still, that's at least something.
They're gonna go top end again, but there's Sentry Ward up for Dire.
The P's might be in trouble. Sentry Ward scouting him out. There's a ping. Maglev Gangtrain still. That's what I like too. It's he's just behaving normally, you know. He isn't reacting all too much about the knowledge that there's an invis hero right around here. But Spin is also in the vicinity. Will there be a support TP? It's Alchemist. He can go in. He has a mech too. Are they baiting this? Is there going to be a TP? I'm waiting for the TP. Alchemist still hanging around. And Alchemist in
mechanism.
Yeah.
Well, that's something different for once.
Definitely. Lapis eats a lot of damage. There's a rage. There's open wounds. Will it be a TP from Alchemist? I'm still waiting for it. There's a living armor. Lapis, look at that. Tankiness. Maglev Gangtrain. There's the reverse. What's it called? Spiked Carapace. Spin. Eats a lot of damage. Turns around. Goes for the ultimate. Whiffs completely. Down goes Quap. Lapis gets open wounded up. He's completely out of everything. He can't do anything. But the living armor. Look at that damage that it's getting reduced from the living armor. Now it's done, and Naix going in for the kill. One last right click, and that will probably be it for our Naix assassin. Maglev Gangtrain, though, gonna run into a Luna. She goes for the ultimate. That's dead Naix.
Good play from Sif there. Just good presence of mind, knowing that Rage was on cooldown for a little bit more. Popping the ultimate, then Lifesteal was dead there.
Mm-hmm.
But that was actually pretty bad for Red Side still.
Yeah, that was.
Lifesteal died. They didn't even need teleport for that, they just 3-man that. So that was really good from Keita's side. And Alchemist just can farm up even more in the mid lane. I guess he decided for the mecha, knowing that Lone Druid and Lifesteal already dish out enough physical damage. But I think maybe the utility of an item like Shadowblade would be better. Just being able to split push, being able to initiate fights properly.
Yeah, I mean, we saw what the temporary invis was able to do. I mean, that netted them a kill on the Tram Protector. I mean, a mech is great for teamfights, but I mean, if you're not going to TP when there's a huge fight happening at top, then why do you have the mech, you know? You might as well have the Shadowblade and then either make something happen in mid, try to go for the pickoffs, and just go for the surprise momentum. But I'm not fully convinced of this Alchemist item build just yet. He will have to convince me the mech will pay off. I mean, both heroes that were soloing the mid lane. By the way, this is a Alchemist versus Tram Protector mid lane. It is ridiculous. And both heroes went for a mech, so again, this is really reminiscent of very old school Dota 1 days in Warcraft 3, and I'm digging it quite a bit, but still. And we'll see how well the item choice pans out from Alchemist as the game here progresses. I mean, it does free up the supports here a little bit to tank up perhaps a little bit, go for other items, have more gold for wards, and perhaps go for a casual vitality boost or some bracers, drums, stuff like that. But Alchemist has been farming the mid lane for a very long time. It just seems like there's not a lot of synergy between his items, his skill build, and what he's deciding to do. He's remaining in mid lane, but not really doing anything. Not skilling Grievous Greed to farm faster, even though he's farming on lane. And buying a mech, even though he's not team fighting. And, you know, just a lot of question marks from my mind. Maybe my understanding just isn't ripe enough for it just yet. Spin, now getting folks back onto the game, has a ultimate orb.
He had a Shadowblade there, then he could have just walked in with it. But now he gets spotted by the Shadow Demon.
But Shadow Demon still manages to get caught by this and gets stunned. Oh, Macropyre does a lot of damage. He self-disrupts defensively. Phlox, Maglev Gangtrain, Frigolith, Stefstal, and Saisawa here. And they pick him up. And now Syphla. He goes for the drums. He's open wounded up. Spin is here, though. Slows down the Maglev Gangtrain, but he goes into Rage. And there's a good Ice Path. Catches only Spin. Is she able to get away, though? Gets entangled by the bear. Down she goes. Scream! No, the ultimate stolen by Frigolith. That's a Sonic Wave. And three heroes from Rat in the Dark killed by Keita underneath their own Tier 1 tower. What a great rotation. What a great execution by Keita. And, well, the mech wasn't needed, now he uses it.
Yeah, it's just the backup, but because they didn't know how much heroes there were, but after Shadow Demon got picked off, their two cores, Luna and Yuffie, both teleported in and died. Or well, Kabutifei was already there, but Luna teleported in and died for no reason there. And maybe a little bit lack of communication because Trent wasn't actually there, so they were not sure to go or not to go.
Yeah, Trent.
Mid lane.
Yeah, Nyxus Assassin getting Ice Path up. There's a huge Sun Spike Carapace. Stuns off Saiso, but not for nearly as long. Now the Haste Rune Boogie, he does have the ultimate ready. Is he going to go for it though? There's a disruption from the Shadow Demon while they're right clicking away on the very, very tanky Alchemist. 1 more second and his mech's also, so he has so much effective HP. There's an ultimate thrown up by Deku as well. He's going to have to use the mech here any second. Maglev Gangtrain shows up. Who's he going to focus? Who is he going to focus? Down goes the Alchemist. He's not sure who to go for. Instead, he decides to go for Ward and then backs out. By the way, he has an Armlet done and that's one death on Keita's side, on one of their most important heroes. But now that I'm looking at this lineup, they have 3 carries. They have a Lone Druid, they have an Alchemist, and they have a Nyx. I have not realized this consciously yet.
Yeah, just great. It's good for that team fight there was what they needed. But in return, look what Lone Druid did in the bottom lane.
Oh my goodness. That's huge. 2 towers. All by himself.
Yeah, that's gonna count if they don't get this mid tower, because your 2 safe lane towers gone, that means you don't have any control over your jungle anymore. Radiant's bottom tower and there's just a lot of less space for Luna to farm up, so
Lapis gonna have to use his ultimate to get away here. No, he actually tries to TP, that might cost him very much! And he barely makes it, this guy's got balls of ice.
Yeah, that's what they do in Finland. Crazy plays like that all around from Red in the Dark, but it's not paying off for them. Keita's just too solid of a team to fall for those risky plays.
Yeah, they as you said, solid. That describes their playstyle. It's just very solid play. Just good decisions, good execution, good draft, good laning. It's everything. Yeah. It's just very good.
They don't do crazy cute things. They don't pick crazy. Or maybe the Alchemist was a bit crazy, but they're just playing Dota the way it should be played. Just doing everything right and depending on doing more things right than your opponent. Mm-hmm.
Ultimate by Luna as well as the Roof Trellen and the Queen of Pain as well. Immediate steal. No, the Rubik still had it. 2 heroes dead from Keita. Nyx on the other side. Where's Luna? She finally goes down and it's 2 heroes dead from Rat in the Dark. And the Roshan is going to the Dire. Who still has the Aegis? Is there still a fight happening somewhere? Because I hear... Well, Aegis goes to Lifestealer. Roshan goes to the Dire, and it's a 2-4-2 trade.
Yeah, so that's good for Keita right now. I think they're happy to trade 2 supports for the Luna and the Nyx session. Mm-hmm. Especially because Red and Dark, the only thing they have going for them is high farm on Luna. Bottom lane.
Bottom lane. Oh man, what a good TP into a stun from Alchemist, and that's an easy kill on Tramp Protector.
He didn't expect what he actually did. He charged the stun and then teleported. So, mm-hmm. And when he got an instant 4 second stun on Trent Attacker's face, mm-hmm. Didn't expect that. And yeah, he got killed there.
It was very good stuff. Keita, as you said, solid Dota coming out of these guys. And again, there's a lot at stake, Rat in the Dark. They need to do their best to try and turn this around. I mean, the Tram Protector worked so well earlier, but today, Keita. I mean, they didn't use the Tram Protector against Keita, they used it against a different team, and the name slipped my mind. Do you perhaps remember which game it was?
Which one do you mean?
The game we cast today, where Rat in the Dark had used Tram Protector already.
Oh, against TM, Typical Mistakes.
Yeah, that was exactly, Typical Mistakes. And
yeah, you could see the lack of experience in Typical Mistakes there, not knowing what to do against a pick like Tram Protector, not switching targets properly and trying, which lost them the game there, but... Top lane
spin
now.
Top lane. They're going to get a nice pickup on Steph style. This time, the solid support, a little bit out of position. Paying with his life for that. And yeah, as you said, that's what I was getting at too, is that Keita, I'm not going to say they fell for it, but they realized the strength of it, and they paid a heavy price for that lesson, because they had already lost 2 or 3 heroes to that Tram Protector living armor, and then they learn from that quickly. And I think that's very important in Dota as well, being able to learn and adapt to your enemy during the game. And that's what Keita has portrayed time and time again within this game, and they're on the way to winning a second game in this best of three, and thus qualifying for the Defense Season 4 main event. And this is something that Rat in the Dark definitely want to achieve themselves, and the question is, how can they do this? They have the Nyx Assassin, they have the mobile fighting lineup, but it doesn't seem like it's working out so well just now. Is Keita's positioning just too good, or is Rat in the Dark making some mistakes here?
Red in the Dark is doing plays that they can do against lesser experienced teams like Difficult Mistakes, but against a solid team like Kato, you can't play aggressive like that. You can't dive in head first towers. That's just not gonna happen anymore. Kato knows exactly what they need to do with situations like that. And they just deal with it properly. And now there's an Orchid on Lifestealer.
Mm-hmm.
So, if there's not gonna be BKB on Queen of Fame, I think she's going in for Hex immediately, which she will have decently soon, but if she just get Orchided, then Lifestealer will eat her up before she can be able to do anything.
That's true. That is absolutely great timing for Keita, and the even worse thing is that they don't realize that he has it. The tier 1 on bottom drops, the Orchid isn't just yet on the Lifestealer, but they still decide to go for the fight. He has the Aegis. Look at that effective HP. Lapis gets focused down, the mech is there, the ultimate from Boogie as well. Good defensive disruption. Is it going to be enough? The ultimate from Queen of Pain hits two heroes. Out comes Maglev Gangtrain. The ultimate from Luna does a lot of damage as well, but she goes down first. Buyback from Nyx right away. Three heroes dead from Rat in the Dark alongside the buyback from Nyx Assassin, and the only one surviving is the Train Protector, who is invis and TP's out.
He still had his Orchids in Courier. I thought they would have waited for that, but they teamfighted without it, and just, yeah, they just won the teamfight there because they have three cores who are just, they don't have more farm than enemy heroes, but more levels and better items because they got some skill, some up control. But the only problem for them right now is they're in bottom lane, and there's only tier 3 standing left there, so they don't have the tower anymore to push. I don't know why they don't just go something like top lane, where there's still tier 1 standing.
Yeah, maybe they're tunnel visioning it out a bit, and they're like, oh guys, there's still a tier 2 in mid, and there's even a tier 1 up on top. I think we gotta rotate here or do something. That fight, what makes it so scary for Rat in the Dark, is that Keita were able to essentially wipe Rat aside from the Train Protector, and that was without the Orchid on Naix. They were just able to go in, and Naix was very low on life. He didn't even lose his Aegis, and he initiated with 200 HP, turned on the armlet, just started right-clicking, and they were able to make something happen. Now Sifla, way out of position, no defensive disruption. What a great silence onto our friend the Shadow Demon. He was not able to do anything. Great play by Frigo lead on, no, by Steph Style on Naix. No, who is it?
Maglev Gangtrain.
Yes.
No.
MGT. My goodness. Very, very good play by the guy, and just good understanding. Shadow Demon was coming in to defensively disrupt, immediate silence on him, and that was Luna's death sentence.
They want to go in again. They're just not pushing tier 1 tower top because they know Red's gonna get out of their base, and then they're gonna get another pick off.
Oh man, silence on Boogie. He gets killed as well, that's just too much. Keita is completely destroying this game right now.
Yeah, and there's no Warster for Red, so they don't actually know where the enemy is. And yet, I don't think they're gonna go past the tier 3 tower anytime soon. Because Keita might just as well keep waiting up there. They don't know.
Yeah, there's a BKB done on the Alchemist now as well. Four staff on Jakiro, so that's gonna help him stay alive during the team fights. Also, helping him in his positioning. I'm loving that Orchid pickup on Lifestealer. Just realizing they're very far ahead. That Queen of Pain has the potential to be that game changer inside the team fights due to her large amount of AoE damage and a burst. So you go for that Orchid because you know that she isn't going for a BKB. And just as I say that, she finishes her upper Hex. So it's kind of fighting fire with fire. But whoever pulls the trigger first is definitely in a better situation. But if Queen of Pain gets silenced, then you're completely right. She is in huge trouble.
And if Lifestealer gets Rage up, he's gonna kill her before she uses the Hex. Mm-hmm. Because she doesn't actually have something like a Ghost Scepter, which would have been really great against him. Now Lundru is pushing top lane. He's gonna back out for now, but I think they're gonna engage really soon here.
Yeah. If like, what can Rat in the Dark do right now? If we look at the farm on Luna, she has a Manta Style. That's pretty good, but we're 27 minutes into the game. She needs more. How is Spin looking? He got a pretty damn fast sheep stick. I gotta give him that. Boogie, Blink Dagger, Mech. The items are pretty good on their side. If we compare that though, let's actually have a look at the other guy's items. So that BKB and Akuma is definitely gonna hurt, but I mean the other Rubick and Lone Druid, they barely have anything. Actually, no. Let's have a look at his bear.
Hyperstone. Blink Dagger though.
On top of his armlet, and they are going aggressive. Naix is not there, but he has a TP.
Yeah, they're gonna look for teamfight here, but I think...
Ice path. Stun is cancelled. Stun gets channeled up by Sisu. Is he gonna throw it out? Is he gonna go for it? Lapis eats a huge stun. Defensive disruption coming out. Maglev Gagrin comes up from the side, and there's that hex onto him. He didn't rage before, but Spin is also silenced. Can't do anything. There's an ultimate from Boogie. Immediate rage cancelled by Maglev Gangtrain. Nyx Assassin already dead. They're chasing after Luna. That's going to be a huge kill. The stun flies. Luna is going to drop after another right click. Further north, we have a killing spree by Floxbox after he picked off the Luna. Now Boogie fighting against Frigo lead. Daco also there. Spin rejoins the team fight. Goes for the scream. Down goes Rubik. But support is here. Keita on the run up. Saiso throws out another stun. Spin still stuns. Good disruption by Daco. Keeps him alive for now. Queen of Pain is going to make it out alive, but Shadow Demon going to pay with his own life. Queen of Pain makes it out though. What a good disruption by the support player here.
That's what's important. Queen of Pain makes out there. It's not important that the Nyx and Shadow Demon died. They got something in return there, but it's still bad for them. They're losing kills, they're losing teamfights. Don't teamfight when you're behind like that and you lack so much map control and farm on your heroes. Try to smoke up, get a pickoff, because now that you have a hex on Queen of Pain, you actually have a huge initiation range for pickoffs. You can just use that 1200 range blink and then the range of the hex to inject on anyone who is overextending. Just smoke up, blink hex, and then get a pickoff, get out. That's all. Don't try to teamfight like that because it's going to happen over and over and over and over again.
Yeah, I mean, you're hitting the nail on the head because Keita, they also have, not only are they very far ahead, but look at their heroes. They also have these three extremely tanky, beefy heroes, and especially if you're behind on items and you don't have the damage output, fighting them is suicide. So I agree, they need to play this differently. They need to, as you said, smoke up, try to find a pickoff. Granted, it's not going to be easy, but it's definitely a wiser choice than I would rather see Ragnarok trying to find those pickoffs and not succeeding because Keita's positioning is too good, even though I don't think that's possible because they found, for example, Jakira a while ago on top, out of position. But I would rather see them looking for pickoffs, smart pickoffs, and not succeeding and then losing the game instead of running and getting wiped and then losing the game. I think you're completely right there, saying that perhaps a strategy change is required. Especially Luna, she's not spending a lot of time farming at all, but considering how much time
she
spends...
Look at this. You're gonna smoke up right under the bar, I think.
Oh no.
Oh my.
Oh no.
It's not gonna be any surprise for Keita. Well, he has sentries, why didn't he just drop one?
This is Rat in the Dark, just... I feel for these guys, honestly. It's... Ward. Yeah, I feel for those guys, honestly. Maglev Gangtrain, still. How?
Why was he there? They know they smoked up. They probably set it over teams again. That shows the thing with the Queen of Fame was Queen of Fame was supposed to. She blinked in.
Look at that! Reaction. Look at that! That face. Oh no!
Just Queen of Fame showing using the effectiveness of the hex before he was able to use rage.
Yeah, that's what you just. That's what you said.
So that was. Poor play by Mega King Trend there. Keita, knowing that Red and Dark has a little bit more mob control right now, they can do a little bit more. They're just gonna sit back, wait for lives here to get back up. Because even though he died there, he got picked off, they're not behind yet. Yes. They're in a comfortable position to just team fight again. They have no problems in waiting, knowing that they have the better late game anyway.
Mm.
With three carry heroes. Look at that, Lone Druid, Alchemist, and Lifesteal. And that's the benefit that you get when you put heroes like Alchemist mid. And once you get to late game, you just got way more than a Trap Attacker or a Queen of Fang. You can get that from farm. And that's why I personally also like heroes like Sven and Jara for all support, because if the game goes too late, just farm up and you'll win because you just have more carries. And that's what's going to happen for Keita right now. That's why Red needs to focus on getting more of those pickoffs. They can't fight 5v5.
Yep, absolutely. Queen of Pain, she actually opted to go for Ghost Scepter, which is actually also a pretty nice choice. Cost-effective way to just stay away from her Bane, the Life Stealer, but... I know, at this point, Keita is so powerful, and... I feel like they had a time window of about 5 to 10 minutes where they could have done exactly what you said with the pickoffs, looking for that. Now they go for initiation, they're looking for a fight. This is desperation! Out comes the ultimate from Sifla. Boogie throws out his ultimate in turn. Saiso shows up, just starts right clicking like crazy. Two heroes down from Rad. This is not working out for them. Lapis has to back out. Queen of Pain also drops three heroes down. This is another lost team fight. Daco gonna be following and that's four heroes dead. Nyx Assassin disconnects out. The GGs get called. Rat in the Dark are beat, and Kaeda qualifies for the defense season 4. And I'm happy to be able to watch this. That was pretty good games, but that was just a desperate initiation by Rat.
And the graph just showed the feel of the game. Gold graph just going down and down and down and down. Rat trying to keep it in their favor, but it's just not working out for them. And it's small things like smokes being fucked up like that. It's just small things that can really cost you the game here, and that's what did it for Rat.
Wow. Kaeda advances and qualifies for the defense season 4, which is this time around sponsored by Aizo. Big thank you to our sponsor for making this possible. Congratulations, Kaeda. Thank you, Rat in the Dark, for participating. Hope to see more of you guys in the future. It's been a great pleasure being able to spectate these games. And I am looking forward to the start of the defense season 4. Tomorrow there will be, I think it's the Aizo Cup. This is, by the way, the end of the defense season 4 qualifiers. The real deal will be starting within the next few days. So I do want to thank you guys for watching. Want to thank all of the Joint Dota staff, Holy Master, Kunya, Xenorath, all the staff people that made that were updating the drafts on the homepage, the ticker, making sure that everybody can just go on the homepage. It's a lot of work to keep things updated, so I feel like these guys are kind of underappreciated. So big shout out to all these guys for making it possible. Really appreciate it. Also, a huge thank you to you guys for tuning in and watching, and I hope you guys enjoyed this game as much as I have. And at last but not least, a very big thank you to you, Ezalor, for keeping me company today and making sure I don't say too many stupid things and just being a nice guy. Thank you so much for coming on. It's been a pleasure, man.
No problem, man. Any day for you.
All right, guys, that was it for the night. I'll be going offline uploading the VODs, though, before I do so. Again, a big thank you to you guys. Please follow me on Twitter, at EpicCommentary. I will be uploading the VODs on the YouTube, on the Join Dota YouTube. So that's youtube.com/joindota. I will be making a playlist for that as well, so you can easily access those. Be sure to hit that little heart button on Twitch as well, and follow me on Twitter, as I said, to be informed when I go live again the next time. And I will be happy to have the chance to cast for you again in the future. Again, to all you guys in the chat, have a nice evening and see you soon. Bye-bye.